Welcome to Learning Radius. Welcome to Learning Radius Current Affairs 2020-21. In this video, we'll be discussing environment ecology. In the last video, we covered 40 topics. And this video also will be covering another 10 topics. And the 10 topics of discussion are Siloam and Enfuser, Blue Flag Beaches, Stockholm Convention on POPs, Abbott-Elfuza Nephdiaphensis, Zombie Fires, Peacock Soft Shell Turtle, Malayan Giant Squirrel, Harbor Busters, Concern on Pollution and Frothing in Yamuna River, WII Experts Evaluate Sites in MP for Cheetah Reintroduction. So the 10 topic of discussion are WII Experts Evaluate Sites in MP for Cheetah Reintroduction, Concern on Pollution and Frothing in Yamuna River, Harbor Busters, Malayan Giant Squirrel, Peacock Soft Shell Turtle, Zombie Fires, Abbott-Elfuza Nephdiaphensis, Stockholm Convention on POPs, Blue Flag Beaches, SILAM Siloam and Enfuser. Now the first topic of discussion is Siloam and Enfuser. IMD operationalizes advanced high resolution air quality early warning system for Delhi and India. So there is a first discussion. IMD operationalizes advanced high quality or advanced high resolution air quality early warning system for Delhi and India. The air quality forecast model system for integrated modeling of atmospheric composition, that is Siloam. So what is Siloam? That is important system for integrated modeling of atmospheric composition. So the air quality forecast system for integrated modeling of atmospheric composition for India has been further improved by implementing global emission inventories, CAM's GLOB 2.1 supplemented with EDGAR 4.3.2 focus and mineral fine anthropogenic particulate matter at 10 km resolution. So that is the air quality forecast model system for integrated modeling of atmospheric composition, that is Siloam. So what is SILAM? That is System for Integrated Modeling of Atmospheric Composition for India has been further improved by implementing global emission inventories. So that is the discussion. Now a very high resolution city scale model, Enfuser. Enfuser, it is Environmental Information Fusion Service for Delhi, has been operationalized by identifying the air pollution hotspots and pollution up to street level. So two terms as it is in discussion. One is related to one is Siloam, SILAM, that is System for Integrated Modeling of Atmospheric Composition. Next one is Enfuser, Environmental Information Fusion Service for Delhi, has been operationalized to identify the air pollution hotspots and pollution up to street level. Siloam and Enfuser have been developed in technical collaboration with Finnish Meteorological Institute. The speciality of the Enfuser is the high utilization of measurement data such as air quality observation, a detailed description of the road network, buildings, land use information, high resolution satellite images, ground elevation and population data. So that is about Siloam and Enfuser. Siloam and Enfuser have been developed in technical collaboration with Finnish Meteorological Institute. The speciality of the Enfuser is the high utilization of measurement data such as the air quality observations, a detailed description of the road network, buildings, land use information, high resolution satellite images, ground elevation and population data. Now the Enfuser natively taps into operative IMD's regional Siloam access point. Enfuser results are being evaluated with the satellite measurement and observation. Model is found to capture the hotspots over Delhi very well. So Enfuser results are being evaluated with the satellite measurement and observations. Model is found to capture the hotspots over Delhi very well. Siloam model have been extensively validated against observation of Indian region. So that's about Siloam and what does Enfuser is about. So Enfuser, once again, it is Environmental Information Fusion Service for Delhi, has been operationalized to identify the air pollution hotspots and pollution up to street level. That is about Enfuser. And next one is Blue Flags Beaches. The 8 beaches in India that have been bagged the coveted eco label Blue Flag from the International Agency Foundation for Environmental Education Denmark. And it includes Rishikonda Beach, Shivrajpur, Gokhla, Kasarkot, Padubidri, Kapat, Golden and Radhanagar. India has bagged the third best award for best practices on pollution control in the coastal region, that is about blue flag certification. In the earlier video, I conveyed what is basically about blue flag certification. At the same time, what is BEACH and what is P is about. So the blue flag certification is given the Denmark-based Foundation for Environment Education. So the Denmark Foundation for Environment Education is FWE. Then Rishikonda Beach is the only one beach in the state which was selected by the Union Government for development to match international standard under BEAMS. So what is BEAMS? Beach Environment and Aesthetic Management Service Project. The basic criteria for getting the certification are safety or security, pollution free, good bathing water quality, environmental education of beach users. A blue flag beach should have beaches for tourists to relax, shower to enable them to take a bath after a dip, a gymnasium and a proper solid waste disposal system, among other things. So the basic criteria for getting the certification are safety or security, pollution free, good bathing water quality and environmental education of beach users. A blue flag beach should have beaches for tourist spot to relax, shower to enable them to take a bath after dip, a gymnasium and a proper solid waste disposal system, among other things. So this is the basic discussion about blue flag beaches, and in the earlier video I explained much in detail related to blue flag certification. So again, Foundation for Environment Education, that is FEE, is in discussion. 8 beach in India that have bagged the coveted eco label blue flag for the international agency Foundation for Environment Education Denmark, there's a discussion about. Next discussion about Stockholm Convention on POPs. The Union Cabinet ratified ban of 7 persistent organic pollutants listed under Stockholm Convention. The regulation inter alia prohibited the manufacture, trade, use, import and export of 7 chemically named chlordecone, hexabromobiphenyl, hexabromodiphenyl ether and heptabromodiphenyl ether, commercial octabidii, tetrabromodiphenyl ether and pentabromodiphenyl ether, commercial pentabidii, pentachlorobenzene, hexabromocyclodecane, hexachlorobutadiene. So these are the 7. So Union Cabinet ratified ban of 7 persistent organic pollutants. So these are the 7 POPs listed under Stockholm Convention. The regulation inter alia prohibited the manufacture, trade, use, import and export of 7 chemicals. So once again, I'll tell the name of the 7 chemicals. One is chlordecone. Second one is hexabromobiphenyl. Third one is hexabromodiphenyl ether and heptabromodiphenyl ether, that is commercial octabidii, tetrabromodiphenyl ether and pentabromodiphenyl ether, pentachlorobenzene, hexabromocyclodecane and hexachlorobutadiene. So these are the 7 POPs that is there in the discussion. And what is Stockholm Convention is about? Stockholm Convention is a global treaty to protect human health and environment from POPs, which are identified chemical substances that persist in the environment, bioaccumulate in living organism, adversely affect human health, environment and have properly of long range environmental transport. So the Stockholm Convention is a global treaty to protect human health and environment from POPs, which are identified chemical substances that persistent in the environment, bioaccumulate in living organism, adversely affect human health, environment and have the property of long range environmental transport. So that is what called Stockholm Convention is about. India had ratified the Stockholm Convention on January 13, 2006 as per Article 25 Clause 4, which enable it to keep itself in a default opt-out position such that amendments in various annexes of the convention cannot be enforced on it unless the instrument of ratification or acceptance or approval or accession is explicitly deposited with UN Depository. So that is, India had ratified the Stockholm Convention on January 13, 2006 as per Article 25 Clause 4, and I explained which enable it to keep itself in a default opt-out position such that amendments in various annexes of the convention cannot be enforced on it unless an instrument of ratification or acceptance or approval or accession is explicitly deposited with UN Depository. So that's a discussion about the Stockholm Convention and the 7 POPs. Next one is Apatophyta naphtophensis, that is, it is a new freshwater crab species found recently on the edge of a small stream in Namdapa Tiger Reserve. So it is naphtophensis, you can read in that particular manner. So it is related to Namdapa Tiger Reserve. The genus About Alfusa is named after the Abar Hills. The species Namdapensis is named after Namdapa. So Namdapa, named a national park in 1983, is known for its rich biodiversity and believed to be the rare area that harbors four large cats, tiger, snow leopard, clouded leopard and leopards. So Namdapa, that is significant here, we can read it as Namdapa fences or Namdapensis. So the Namdapa, a national park in 1983, known for its rich biodiversity and believed to be the rare area that harbors four large cats. So Namdapa, significant, complete geographic understanding and GK understanding of Namdapa is very important. And Namdapa believed to be the rare area that harbors four large cats in the country. That is, one is tiger, second one is a snow leopard, third one is a clouded leopard, and fourth one is a leopard. Now, other than that, Abar Hills, bordered by the Mishmi Hills and Miri Hills, are historically known for the Abar expedition, a punitive expedition against Abars in the Northeastern Frontier Agency, which corresponds to parts of present-day Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. From October 1911 to April 1912, the expedition had thrown up a plethora of new floral and faunal species, making it a zoological and botanical expedition as well. So that is, Abar Hills, bordered by the Mishmi Hills and Miri Hills, are historically known for the Abar expedition, a punitive expedition against the Abars in the Northeastern Frontier Agency from October 1911 to April 1912. So Abar Hill is also significant, and the basic discussion about Mishmi Hills and Miri Hills should be there in your mind in connection with the Abar Hills, at the same time in connection with Namdapa. So here the discussion is a new freshwater crab species found recently on the edge of a small stream in Namdapa Tiger Reserve. So Namdapa Tiger Reserve is in discussion, a fresh crab species as it is found. So in connection with that, we should have clarity more about that particular tiger reserve, that is Namdapa Tiger Reserve. Next is zombie fires. According to a new study, zombie fires becoming more frequent in addition to fires occurring in one's frozen tundra. Zombie fire is a fire from a previous growing season that can smolder under the ground, which is made up of carbon-rich peat. According to a study by scientists from the Institute of Arctic and Alpine Research at the University of Colorado, Boulder, United States, when the weather warms, the fire can reignite. So according to a new study, zombie fires becoming more frequent in addition to fires occurring in the once frozen tundra. So what is tundra? At the same time, what is zombie fires? Where it occurs? I explained. A zombie fire is a fire from a previous growing season that can smolder under the ground, which is made up of carbon-rich peat. According to study by scientists from the Institute of Arctic and Alpine Research at the University of Colorado, Boulder in the United States, when the weather warms, the fire can reignite. So that is, a zombie fire is in discussion. The study urged global cooperation, investment and action in monitoring fires. It called for learning from the indigenous people of the Arctic about how fire was traditionally used. It was said that new permafrost and peat sensitive approaches to wildland firefighting and were needed to save the Arctic. So that's a discussion about zombie fire. Next is peacock softshell turtle. Peacock softshell turtle, a turtle of a vulnerable species, has been rescued from a fish market in Assam Silchar. So peacock softshell turtle, a turtle of a vulnerable species, that is in discussion. The conservation status of peacock softshell turtle is vulnerable on IUCN Red List. This species is confined to India, Bangladesh and Pakistan. It is widespread in northern and central part of Indian subcontinent. So peacock softshell turtle, a turtle of a vulnerable species, has been rescued from a fish market in Assam Silchar. The species is also listed under Appendix 1 of CITES, the protected under the Schedule 1 of Indian Wildlife Protection Act. That's a discussion. Now, major threats, the species is heavily exploited for its meat and calliope under the outer cartilaginous rim of the shell. Threats in River Ganga to the species are those generic for all large river turtles, including reduction of fish stock as a result of overfishing, pollution, increase in the river traffic and sand mining, and among others. So the species is heavily exploited for its meat and calliope. That is the most important point. And the species is also listed under Appendix 1 of CITES, protected under Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act. Its conservation status is vulnerable on IUCN Red List. So peacock softshell turtle, a turtle of a vulnerable species, has been rescued from a fish market in Assam Silchar. That is the discussion. The species is confined to India, Bangladesh and Pakistan. It is widespread in the northern and central part of Indian subcontinent. Next is Malayan giant squirrel. A first of its kind study by the Zoological Survey of India under the Union Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has projected that number of Malayan giant squirrel, that is Ratufa bicolor, could decline by 90% in India by 2050. Malayan giant squirrel is Ratufa bicolor. So Malayan giant squirrel is in discussion. A first of its kind study by the Zoological Survey of India under the Union Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has projected the number of Malayan giant squirrel, that is Ratufa bicolor, could decline by 90% in India by 2050. It is also known as black giant squirrel. It's one of the world's largest squirrel species, has a dark upper body, pale underparts and a long busty tail. In India, it is found in the northeastern part of the country, covering the states of Sikkim, West Bengal, Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya and Nagaland. Mostly found in evergreen and semi-evergreen forest of northeast India. That's about black giant squirrel. This species is listed as threatened. So this species is listed as near threatened in IUCN Red List of threatened species. There are three species of giant squirrel found in India. The Malayan species is native to northeast India. The other two species, Indian giant squirrel and grizzled giant squirrel, are distributed mostly across peninsular and southern India. Next is Haubara bustards. Pakistan has issued special permit to Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman and two other members of the royal family to hunt the internationally protected Haubara bustard during the hunting season 2020-21. The hunters had been allocated certain hunting areas in two provinces, Baluchistan and Punjab, the Dawn newspaper report. So Haubara bustard is in discussion. It is related to the Pakistan has issued special permission to Saudi Arabia, Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman and two other members of the royal family to hunt the internationally protected Haubara bustard during the hunting season. So that was reported by a newspaper, that is Dawn. And here from UPSC point of view, that species, we should have a basic fundamental regarding Haubara bustard and what is the species is about. Now Haubara bustard is a resident of the colder Central Asian region. It migrates southwards every year to spend its winters in a relatively warmer environment in Pakistan. IUCN Red List status is vulnerable on since 2014. So that is about Haubara bustard. So Haubara bustard is a resident of the coldest Central Asian region and it migrates southward every year to expand its winters in relatively warmer environment in Pakistan. And IUCN Red List is vulnerable on since 2014. So Haubara bustard as a species, there should be clarity what is the nature and character of Haubara bustard and what is the IUCN status and where it actually live and where it migrate. So there is a basic understanding you're supposed to know about the species, and the species is important from UPSC prelims point of view. Next is concern on pollution and frothing in Yamuna River. Central Pollution Control Board CPCB has raised some concern on pollution and frothing in River Yamuna. The CPCB has asked Delhi and other states for effective sewage treatment. It has also sought action taken report ATR from all concerned agencies by 15 December 2020. So Central Pollution Control Board, CPCB, has raised concern on pollution and frothing in River Yamuna. The CPCB has asked Delhi and other states for effective sewage treatment. So CPCB in discussion, at the same time, the most important, Yamuna as a river as such is in discussion. In the past, CPCB observed froth formation and increase in ammonia level in River Yamuna. It issued direction to Delhi Jal Board to submit time-bound action plan to ensure compliance to norms by sewage treatment plants. Delhi Pollution Control Committee has been directed to take action against non-complying common effluent treatment plants and industrial units. Directions have also been issued to state pollution control boards of Haryana and Uttar Pradesh. There are five major outfalls carrying wastewater into Yamuna, including Najafgarh drain, Shadara drain, Bharapula drain, Delhi gate drain and Mauri gate drain. So here the significant point is Delhi Pollution Control Committee has been directed to take action against non-complying common effluent treatment plants and industrial units. Direction have also been issued to State Pollution Control Board of Haryana and Uttar Pradesh, and the river as such is in discussion is Yamuna. So concern on pollution and frothing in Yamuna River. So the drainage of Yamuna, the basic GK related to Yamuna, at the same time, the geography of Yamuna and the tributaries and distributaries of Yamuna River, as it should be clear in the mind, because Yamuna as a river is there in the discussion. Next one is WII, that is Wildlife Institute of India. Wildlife Institute of India expert evaluate sites in MP for cheetah reintroduction. Experts from Dehradun-based Wildlife Institute of India have visited 4 locations in Madhya Pradesh to research for the perfect habitat for the reintroduction of cheetah within the nation. 4 locations are the Kunopalpur Sanctuary in MP, Shivapur district, then Nauradehi Sanctuary in Sagar district, the Gandhi Sagar Sanctuary of the northern boundary of Madhasaur, and Neemuch district and Madhav National Park in Shivpuri district. So 4 locations are the Kunopalpur Sanctuary in MP's Shivapur district, then Nauradehi Sanctuary in Sagar district, the Gandhi Sagar Sanctuary on the northern boundary of Madhasaur, and Neemuch district and the Madhav National Park in Shivpuri district. So these are the 4 locations which is supposed to be there in your mind. So once again, it is about the Kunopalpur Sanctuary. UPSC once does about Kunopalpur Sanctuary. Then it is about the Nauradehi Sanctuary. Then it is the Gandhi Sagar Sanctuary. And the final one is Madhav National Park, that is in Shivpuri district. The Supreme Court gave its approval to introduce African cheetah to a suitable habitat in India on an experimental basis in January 2020. So that's a discussion. Experts from Dehradun-based Wildlife Institute of India have visited 4 locations in Madhya Pradesh to research, so Madhya Pradesh to search for the perfect habitat for the reintroduction of cheetah within the nation. The Supreme Court set up a 3-member committee to guide the National Tiger Conservation Authority on the cheetah reintroduction project. The panel has asked the Wildlife Institute of India to carry out a technical evaluation of all possible sites for the reintroduction of cheetah in the country. The country's last spotted cheetah died in Chhattisgarh in 1947. Cheetah was declared extinct in India in 1952. So that's a discussion. And cheetah is a prominent cat family member and that belongs to subfamily Felinae and is found across Africa and some part of Iran. The cheetah prefers grassland habitat where it has enough space to go after its prey without any obstacles. So cheetah as an species is in discussion, so there should be maximum clarity about cheetah, because cheetah reintroduction as it is there in the news. Cheetah are the world's fastest land mammal. Cheetah are listed as vulnerable by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, that is by IUCN, red list of threatened species. But after a recent study revealed significant population decline, scientists are calling for cheetah to be published to endangered. In North Africa and Asia, they are considered critically endangered. So that's about the details of cheetah. So here, the Wildlife Institute of India experts evaluate sites in MP for cheetah reintroduction. Experts from Dehradun-based Wildlife Institute of India have visited 4 locations in Madhya Pradesh. I mentioned that 4 locations 3 times. Location in Madhya Pradesh to search for the perfect habitat for the reintroduction of cheetah within the nation. The Supreme Court gave its approval to Supreme Court gave its approval to introduce African cheetah to a suitable habitat in India on an experimental basis in January 2020. So that's a discussion about environment ecology. We'll be meeting in the next video with the next 10 topics. So once again, watch the analysis video, have a perfect understanding how UPSC is framing current affairs question, how UPSC is changing a current affair into a beautiful UPSC preliminary question. So the transformation is very, very important. That understanding should be there in your mind. Then only you will get the real grip over the current affairs of environment ecology. Watch the analysis video. At the same time, listen to this current affairs of environment ecology, and in the coming video again I'll be explaining another 10 topics. Have a great study, happy learning to all of you. Calm version is the most productive version. Be calm and have a very productive learning. Thank you all of you.